In this video, we're going to briefly look at soap. These days, there aren't many places where soap is used, and the chances of you using soap in the development process are low. This is because it has largely been replaced by REST API, which we discussed in the previous video. In this video, we will be comparing soap to REST API. If you're not yet familiar with REST API, I recommend watching that video first. Before REST API became popular, there was a widely used protocol called SOAP. By learning about it, we can better understand the advantages of REST API.
So, the point of this is not so much to learn about SOAP, which isn't used much these days, but rather to understand REST API better by comparing it to SOAP.
Well, that's one way to look at it, but SOAP also has its own merits. Let's also discover where SOAP is still being used today and identify its strengths. In the REST API video, we used the example of a library's book management service. Let's compare how the REST API requests and responses used there would be written in SOAP. In REST API, requests were distinguished by HTTP methods and URIs, so the URI could differ according to the contents of request. But in SOAP, all requests are sent to a single, specified URI. The address I just gave is just an example. Now let's look at each task one at a time. First is the read operation, which retrieves the list of books. Let's start with the request. In REST API, we specify a retrieval operation by using the get method, and we use URI to show which resource it's about. Usually, the data written in JSON format is returned as a response. Here's what this request and response look like when written in SOAP.
It seems a lot longer and more complicated. Is this something like HTML?
Yes, it's in a format called XML. While REST API allows for various formats and commonly uses the concise JSON, SOAP stipulates the use of the verbose XML compared to JSON. As a result, for the same request and response, the volume of data sent and received is larger in SOAP than in REST API. In REST API, we were able to express the desired data with just the HTTP method and URI. But in SOAP, you have to write the same request in this much detail. Therefore, POST is mainly used to allow this to be sent in the body. Due to these characteristics and problems, such as CORS discussed in later videos, SOAP is rarely used in web front end. Let's take a look at the content of a request message written in XML. At the top, there is an envelope element. A SOAP message begins and ends with an envelope tag. It can be seen as the envelope itself that holds the message. As we compared POST to a parcel box in the REST API video, let's also compare it to a parcel box here. Header is similar to the invoice attached to the parcel box. It can optionally contain authentication, transaction, other additional information, etc. about the message. Body is the contents of the parcel. That is, the main text, the core information of the message goes here. The body of the request contains the operation you want to call and the parameters and data necessary for it. Get books request, i.e. the operation of getting books, and you can see that the page and the number of books per page are passed as 1 and 10, respectively, and the body of the response contains the results of performing this. Let's examine the create request to add a book this time. You can see that only the content of the body changes like this. In this way, it shows what operation it is with add book request, and the contents of the book are included in it.
So to see what each request in SOAP is trying to do, we just need to look at this body, right?
That's correct. Another important difference is that whilst REST API is data-driven, focusing on which resource is the target, SOAP is function-driven, expressing which service is being requested in the message. In such a way, a service requesting a list of books will be labeled GetBooksRequest, a request for a specific book is GetBookRequest, adding a book is add book request, and modifications or deletions are update book request and delete book request, respectively. This is how what is being done is demonstrated with these verb including sentences. Indeed, contrasting with the REST API that utilize nouns as far as possible.
Comparing and contrasting with other methods like this, I think I can understand the features and advantages of REST API much more clearly.
Yes. It's clear to see how lightweight and read-friendly REST API is. Another important element of SOAP is WSDL. To put it simply, it can be said to be a user manual for services implemented with SOAP.
Doesn't something like that exist for REST API too? It is created between front-end and back-end developers, and it is publicized on the website as API documentation when it's a public API, right?
Yes. However, if that API documentation is something that humans are to look at, meaning it serves the purpose of a reference for developers to program request and response functions, WSDL can be viewed as a document written for programs to read, rather than humans. Normally, client and server programs would load this WSDL file, then implement the functions according to its specification. Hence, this WSDL, too, is written in a strict XML format. It provides detailed representation of how each service should be requested and responded. This can both be a strength and a weakness of SOAP. As strengths, it can provide detailed standardization for services, and based on this document, client and server functions can be automated, simplifying the development process. As a weakness, it is complex and verbose for humans to write and read, and it lacks in flexibility. If this WSDL were to change, both client and server might need to modify their codes. Another disadvantage of SOAP is that it is not easy to cache. First of all, the content of the request is complex XML, making it difficult to cache based on it. Another reason is that all messages are sent via post. Generally, HTTP POST does not get cached. This is because it is mainly used for operations that affect the data possessed by the target, so it is not suitable for caching.
So then, is SOAP only worse than REST API in all respects?
That's not the case. Although it's not as popular, there are still areas where SOAP is used. The first case is when security is very important. SOAP supports security protocols like WS security. Since messaging integrity and confidentiality can be authenticated, it is used in services that require a high level of security, like financial transactions, medical information systems, government services, etc. Especially in services like financial transactions, multiple tasks need to be treated as a single transaction. A transaction refers to when multiple tasks are executed, either all are successfully carried out, or nothing gets carried out. If, during the process of transferring money, the process of withdrawing from my account succeeds, but the process of depositing into the recipient's account fails, it would be a big problem. SOAP also supports protocols that safely handle transactions, making it suitable for services where complex and sensitive procedures take place. The inflexibility I mentioned while explaining WSDL can also work as an advantage when strict protocols are required between the client and the server. Lastly, I mentioned that REST API is stateless, meaning it does not maintain state. SOAP, however, can maintain state if necessary. Therefore, it is also preferred for transactional operations where the state of the previous steps needs to be remembered. For these reasons, SOAP is still used in large services dealing with complex and sensitive logic. We've had time to compare and learn about SOAP in comparison to REST API. In the next video, I will introduce GraphQL, which has a lower market share than REST API, but it is growing rapidly. I'll see you in the next video!